Materials. In the previous lectures, you have seen the concepts of theories of failure. Today, we'll solve two important problems on theories of failure. Let me go through the problem first. The state of stress at a point for a material is given in the figure. Calculate the factor of safety using the two important theories, that is maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory. So the figure is given here. We have the biaxial stress field here. You can see along the x-axis, the direct stress sigma axis 40 megapascals. Along the y-axis, there is a stress, direct stress, that is 125 MPa. Now this is tensile in nature, you can see, and this is compressive. So now to solve this problem, first before that, we'll write the data given here. So stress acting along x-axis 40 newton per mm square and along the y-axis 125 newton per mm square. So this is compressive in nature. Then shear stress along the xy plane is 20 newton per mm square and yield stress for the material is 400 newton per mm square. Now we need to find here the factor of safety we are going to use for the design of material. Now this is as per two theories, maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory. Now, to find the factor of safety, we need to first find the principal stresses. So, principal stresses can be found by taking the values of direct stresses and shear stresses. So, for that, we'll use the equation. The maximum principal stress is equal to sigma x plus sigma y by 2 plus sigma x square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau square. So if we take plus and minus values, we are going to get the maximum principal stress and minimum principal stress. So I have shown here finding the maximum principal stress by substituting the values 40 minus, because this is compressive in nature, 40 minus 125 by 2 square root of 40 plus 125 by 2 whole square plus shear stress is 20, so 20 square. Now, by solving this, we are going to get the value of maximum principal stress as 42.38 newton per mm square. Similarly, by changing this value to negative sign, we can find the minimum principal stress, which I have found out here, that is 127.36 newton per mm square, which is compressive in nature. So this clearly indicates that the maximum principal stress sigma 2 is greater than sigma 1. So taking this value of stress for the comparison with yield stress, we know that the condition for the failure according to maximum principal stress theory is when the maximum principal stress reaches the value of yield stress divided by factor of safety, the failure is going to occur. So substituting the values here, 127.36 and yield stress is given as 400 newton per mm square. Upon substituting this, we are going to get the value of factor of safety, that is 3.14. So now this is according to the maximum principal stress theory. Finding the maximum principal stress, minimum principal stress and equating to the yield stress will get you the factor of safety. Similarly, according to maximum shear stress theory, we can equate the maximum shear stress to shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety. Now for this, we need to find first the maximum shear stress. So maximum shear stress can be found out by taking the differences of the three principal stresses in order. First, sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2, or sigma 2 minus sigma 3 by 2, or sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2. So the largest of these three will give you the maximum shear stress. So at this point, we can assume that sigma 3 is 0. So now let us find the three values and take the largest of the three. Shear stress maximum is equal to, substituting the values, now this is compressive, so minus minus becomes plus, and this is sigma 3 is 0, and here also sigma 3 is 0. So we are going to get the value of maximum shear stress as 84.87 newton per mm square. Similarly, we can find the shear stress at yield point, which is equal to yield stress by 2, and equating, so that value is 400 newton per mm square by 2, So we'll get the value of yield shear stress at yield point 200 Newton per mm square. Now coming to the condition, according to maximum shear stress theory, the failure of the material occurs when the maximum shear stress reaches the shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety. So taking this maximum value and equating it to yield stress, shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety, you will get the factor of safety as 2.35. So we have two values here, one according to maximum principal stress theory, that is n is equal to 3.14, and another is according to maximum shear stress theory, which is 2.35. One more important problem: a cantilever rod is subjected to a load as shown in figure. So you can see this diagram here. Now this is the support and this is the cantilever beam or rod. It is supported at one end, free at the other end. Now you can see here, it is subjected to a bending load of 20 kilonewtons and an axial load of 10 kilonewtons, and also it is subjected to a turning moment or twisting moment of 800 newton meters. Now the distance, the length of this rod is 120 mm. Now this can be drawn on a biaxial stress field like this on the plane. You can see here XY plane. So along the x-axis, you can see the axial stresses acting, and along with the bending stress and the shear stresses acting along the XY plane. Now, for this condition, the material yield stress of the material is 300 MPa. You need to find the diameter of the circular rod according to maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory. So now, first let us find the values of the axial stress and bending stress and also shear stress. So we know that axial stress can be found out by the equation sigma is equal to load by cross section area. So load is 10 kilonewtons divided by pi d square by 4. So let us keep the value of axial stress in terms of unknown value, that is d. Now this is the value of the axial stress. Similarly, bending stress can be calculated by the equation sigma b is equal to 32 load into the distance divided by pi d cube. So substitute the value of bending load, that is 2 kilonewton, into the length from the support, that is 120 divided by pi d cube. So we are going to get the value of the bending stress as 2.445 by d cube. And also shear stress acting can be found out by the turning moment, that is equal to 16t by pi d cube, 16 into 800 newton meters in the clockwise direction. So we will get the equation, the value as 4074 by d cube. So by knowing the two values of direct stresses, that is axial stress and bending stress, along with the lateral stress, that is shear stress, we can find the principal stresses. So maximum principal stress and minimum principal stress can be found out by this equation, that is sigma x plus sigma y by 2 plus square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square by tau square. So substituting the value of the axial stress and bending stress and also shear stress here, so 12.73 by d square plus 2.44 by d cube. So these two values, and along with that, this 1 by 2 square, that is 1 by 4th, and substituting this value along with the shear stress value, that is 40.74 d cube. So we'll get the values of sigma 1, and after, by taking the negative sign, we'll get the value of sigma 2, that is maximum principal stress and minimum principal stress. So once we find the values of maximum principal stress and minimum principal stress, we can apply the conditions through maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory. So now, according to maximum principal stress theory, the condition for failure is when the maximum principal stress reaches the value of yield stress, the failure is going to occur. So by equating this, the yield stress value is given, that is 300 MPa, and the value obtained from this, if you equate, we are going to get the diameter as 26.67 millimeters. Similarly, according to maximum shear stress theory, The failure of a material or a component occurs when the maximum shear stress reaches the value of shear stress at yield point. So now, to find the maximum shear stress, you have to take the difference of principal stresses, that is sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2. So these differences we have to take sigma 1, sigma 2 by 2 and equate it to the shear stress at yield point divided by 2. We are going to get the diameter as 30.63 mm. So these are the diameters obtained by the maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory. Welcome to VTU eShikshana program. Under this initiative, I will be taking mechanics of materials. In this course, I am handling module 4, that is theories of failure and torsion of circular shafts. This is lecture 4. In the first three lectures, I introduced the basic concepts of theories of failure, the need of theories of failure, the different theories of failures, and maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory. What are the design equations for these two theories and how to apply these two theories to predict the failure? And also, we solved different problems on these two theories to find the factor of safety and to find the diameter of the given circular rod. Now, in this fourth lecture, that is the last lecture of theories of failure, I will be summarizing the entire chapter on theories of failure. Theories of failure are essentially set of failure criteria developed to design a machine element or component during its application when it's subjected to a system of complex forces and stresses. Now, it is always significant to predict the mode of failure so that you can develop a design methodology based on a particular failure criteria. Now, when an engineer is given with the problem of designing a specific material, it always becomes very important to fix or place an upper limit on the state of stress that defines material's failure. So that means the maximum limit that a material can withstand, stresses that it can withstand, or the failure stresses. So this will be helpful in designing a component effectively. Now, the different modes of failure in materials are: if the material is ductile, the failure usually specified or identified by the beginning or commencement of yielding, whereas in case of brittle materials, the failure is specified by fracture of the material. Let us see the stress strain diagram given here. In this, you can see two specific graphs, the below one showing the behavior of the material when subjected to loading and its stress strain variation. And the above one shows the variation of stress with strain when it is loaded cyclically for a brittle material. You can observe that in case of a ductile material, there is a specific yield point, and after that, the yielding commences and it reaches a point where a maximum ultimate strength is observed, and then it fails, which is identified as breaking point. But in designing a material, the upper limit is always taken as the yield point, because beyond this point, the material starts yielding or it starts deforming, and the deformation is permanent. Hence, the material is to be designed to withstand the forces within this limit, that is yield point or yield strength of the material. In the other case, that is when brittle material is considered, we can see soon after this
proportionality limit, the material starts deforming without showing any yielding point, and it breaks at this point. So this here, the ultimate strength of the material is taken as the upper limit. Now we can see here, these recordings are made during a simple tensile test conducted on a UTM, where you can see when a material is subjected to tensile test, the neck formation starts and the failure occurs, wherein you can, in case of ductile materials, you can see a cup and cone formation, and in case of brittle materials, there is a fracture. Okay. So now these concepts are very important in applying the theories of failure. The different theories of failure under considerations are a Rankine's theory, that is called as maximum principal stress theory, Guest and Tresca theory, which states that maximum shear stress theory, and then maximum principal strain theory, which is stated by Stent Venants, and then Hayes theory proposed total strain energy, and then von Mises and Henkes proposed maximum distortion energy theory. Out of these two theories, the first two theories, that is maximum principal stress theory and maximum shear stress theory, are very important. Let us just brief these two theories. According to maximum principal stress theory, the condition for failure is when maximum principal stress exceeds the failure stresses. So here the failure stresses are limiting stresses, that is the yield stress. Now this, from this, our condition or equation for safe design becomes maximum principal stress must be less than or equal to permissible stresses, that is yield stress divided by factor of safety. So this we can take it as the condition for safe design as per maximum principal stress theory. In the diagram you can see, so when in a biaxial stress field, sigma 1, sigma 2 are the principal stresses, and the box that is shown here, square, this is the boundary, and the yield stress is the boundary, so that when the material is loaded, the stresses will increase, and when they reach this boundary, beyond this, the material is going to fail. So that means the condition outside this box indicates the failure of material, and a condition inside this shows it is safe. Now this is according to maximum principal stress theory. According to maximum shear stress theory, the failure occurs when the value of the maximum shear stress at any point on the component or element reaches the yield strength. Okay. So that means you can see in the diagram, you can see the principal stresses, sigma 1, sigma 2, and the difference when it reaches the shear stress at yield point, that is the boundary, then the failure of the material occurs. So hence the condition for safe design, we can state that the maximum shear stress should be less than or equal to the shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety. So when the maximum shear stress on a component or a material reaches the value of shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety, the failure is going to occur. Now let us see, there are two cases when triaxial state of stress, we have sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. So in this case, we can find the maximum shear stress by taking the differences of the principal stresses, sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2, sigma 2 minus sigma 3 by 2, and sigma 3 minus sigma 1 by 2. Whichever is the largest should be less than or equal to the yield stress, the shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety. And in case of biaxial stress, biaxial state of stress, sigma 3 is 0. So now the equation reduces to tau max is equal to sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2 or sigma 2 by 2 or sigma 1 by 2, whichever is the largest, must be less than or equal to the shear stress at yield point divided by factor of safety. Now, how to find this shear stress at yield point? This shear stress at yield point is yield stress divided by 2. Now, this is about the maximum shear stress theory. Now, comparing the two theories, the first theory, that is maximum principal stress theory, is suitable for safe design of machine components normally made of brittle materials under triaxial or biaxial stresses. Now, this theory is not suitable for the safe design of machine components made of ductile materials as they are weak in shear. Whereas maximum shear stress theory is suitable for ductile material and it is not suitable for hydrostatic loading. Now, coming to the applications of theories of failure, the theories of failures need to be applied because when an investment is made on certain component or material, you have to make sure that it will not fail during its service life. So to make sure that the life cycle costs are lesser of the components, we need to design so that the failure of the component does not occur. And also to improve the efficiency of the component, improve the durability, and also to be safe during its operation. And in addition to this, it is also designed to meet some other requirements also. Some of the specific applications include aircrafts, automobiles, then part components of aircrafts and automobiles, then turbine blades, and also used in the emerging fields technologies. And also when you are applying you are developing a new material, you need to predict the failure. So in all such cases, theories of failure are very important.